एक ओंकार सतनाम कर्ता पुरख निर्भव निर्वैर अकाल मूरत अजूनी सैभन गुरु प्रसाद। गॉड इज एवरीवेयर एंड इन एवरी वन। ही इज द ट्रुथ इमॉर्टल क्रिएटर विदाउट फियर विदाउट एनमिटी अनबॉर्न एंड सेल्फ क्रिएटेड। दिस अंडरस्टैंडिंग कम्स बाय गुरुज ग्रेस। सो द क्वेश्चन इज वॉट डज द वर्ड गुरु मीन हियर। इज इट मेंट दैट द गुरु इज नेसेसरी फॉर रियलाइजेशन ऑफ गॉड और ट्रुथ? यस, दैट इज वॉट इज मेंट। दीज लाइन्स आर अनइक्विवोकल इन असर्टिंग दैट फॉर गॉड रियलाइजेशन और ट्रुथ रियलाइजेशन द ग्रेस ऑफ गुरु इज इंडीड नीडेड। You have asked, what does Guru mean? Who is the Guru? The one who can take you towards truth, the one who can display to you your falseness and also kindle in you a love for truth is the Guru. The one who can display to you your bondages and also kindle in you the courage to be free is the Guru. The thing has to be very practical. You must actually come to see not only that you are unnecessarily stuck, but also that it is possible to move away and fly. The company of the Guru must make this practically possible. So the Guru is the one in whose company this event actually happens. If it is not actually happening, then the Guru is just for namesake. The Guru is not identified by his title or knowledge or erudition or followership. The only mark of the guru is his ability to actually practically bring about a shift in your consciousness. A shift towards the better, a shift towards the higher, a shift towards freedom. If that shift is not occurring, then neither are you a student, nor is the guru a guru. Look how tremendously powerful these words are. Millions and billions have been stirred by them, stirred awake by them. And therefore, these words are Guru Prasad. Does the Guru need to be necessarily a person? Not necessarily. The Adi Granth, the Guru Granth Sahib, is considered the immortal, everlasting Guru of the Sikhs. There were 10 physical Gurus, and then there is the Adi Granth. The Adi Granth is therefore called as the Guru Granth Sahib. It is now the Guru. So does the Guru have to be a person or a book? Not necessarily. So if you go to Dattatreya, if you visit the Udhut Gita, he will tell you of various gurus as a pigeon, a python, a hunter, it depends on your readiness and receptivity. If you are so very ready that you can learn even from a falling leaf, as Lao Tzu did, then a falling leaf is the Guru. The paint on the wall can be the Guru if you are standing ready to precipitate. A little bit of movement the most minor stir and the thing happens. It is just that the thing must happen. That is the test. However, most people are not in a state of such fantastic readiness where they would be able to learn from the paint on the wall or a falling leaf or a cow or a pigeon. Most people are not even ready enough to learn from a human being. Even among human beings, most people require special ones. Therefore, it would be prudent to first of all try among humans. Try elsewhere only if you are very, very ripe or very, very unlucky. If you are so unlucky that you cannot find a human being or a set of human beings worth learning from, then make the clouds and the sky your teacher. Or if you have come to a state of deep inner readiness, then the universe will anyway become your teacher. However, remember that this is only for the very ripe or the very unlucky. For most people, it is best to seek human contact and learn from a living contemporary teacher. That's the practical thing to do. Then it's been further quoted, Hukam Rajai Chalna Nanak Likhiya Nal. Nanak says, the answer is to stay in the will of God. Nanak says, the answer is to stay in the will of God. You could read the word answer as solution. Nanak says, the solution is to stay in the will of God. So the accompanying question is, what is the will of God? In these verses, God is referred to as a third person. But in the first verse, it's mentioned that God is in everyone. So does this mean that these verses instruct us to stay in that part of the self that is truth or God? But how do we recognize and stay at the truth? The will of God is that you stay loving and discerning enough to not to obey ungodly wills. God is the giver of freedom. God does not impose His will upon humans. Being freedom absolute, God wishes and blesses humans with nothing but freedom absolute. What else is God except for absolute freedom? And if God is absolute freedom, what else can He give you? Absolute freedom. And if He is the giver of absolute freedom, why will He have a will of His own to impose upon you or to even suggest to you? Actually, God has no will. The word will is applicable only to limited beings and persons, not to the absolute one. But still, Nanak Sahib is talking of Hukum Rajai Chalna Nanak Likhiya Nal. Obviously, there is something deep that he wants to say. What is he saying? He is saying that freedom only begets freedom. If there is a will that freedom has, the will is to further the freedom. So that's the only thing that God wishes for you, that is the hukum. Stay free. And you can stay free only if you have discernment, discrimination. Only if you are able to call out bondage as bondage. Most of the times we welcome bondage itself as freedom. That's how bondage occupies our lives. God wants us to love freedom so intensely that we are able to spontaneously and effortlessly detect the faintest footsteps of bondage. Even before bondage comes to us and besieges us, we should be able to detect it from a distance. That's what the hukum is. That's what the divine will is. Be so intensely in love with freedom that bondage is spotted out. From 1,000 miles away. It has no way to get close to you. The divine will is that your free will must remain free. We are creatures of self-professed free will, right? We keep saying, this is what I love, this is what I want, this is what I like, this is where I want to go. We keep making such statements continuously, don't we? So we live by our free will. What does God want then? He wants that our free will must always support freedom. Our free will must actually remain free. Usually, usually, that which we call as free will is just a misnomer. It is free only in name. We call it free will, but it is not free at all. We say, my free will. But this so-called my free will is neither mine nor free. So what then is the divine hukum, the divine will? That your free will should actually be free. That you should not be using the faculty of choice to support your own incarceration. Getting it? God wants you to see rightly, decide rightly, and then act rightly. We are beings of choice. At every moment, we have choices. God wants us to reject all the false choices. What does He want us to choose then? Reject everything that is false. That's all that God wants. The remainder is your playground. Once you have rejected all that which is false, all that which remains is your playground. Play there. God just watches and laughs. He has no particular will of His own. Is that clear? We are saying freedom absolute can only want freedom for all the ones who proceed from itself. What does God want? He wants you to want rightly. What does God want? He wants you to want freedom. No, is there anything specific that God wants? Since God is not specific, how can He want anything specific? God loves you so much that He has vested all powers of decision making in you. He has divested Himself of all powers, and all the powers have been given to you. You make of your life whatever you want to make of your life. And He will not interfere even if you mess up your life. Because He has already given the best that He could. What more can He give? He hasn't held back anything. I suppose God would be praying a lot. Because there is nothing left for him to do. Having done the best that you can, what else can you now do? He has given you the power to love. He has given you the faculty to discern. He has given you a body to act. He has blessed you with intellect and memory. And he has, most of all, given you the ability to attend and understand. If you still falter and suffer, God can only pray. Since the saints abide by God's wish, so they say God's will, God's hukum, God's command. The common man continuously stands in insubordination to God's will. The giver of freedom wanted you to remain free. The common man continuously chooses bondage. And therefore I am saying God can only pray for him. It is the mark of sainthood to consider the will of God as hukum or command. When you consider something as hukum, then you cannot violate it. But the common man continuously violates freedom. He does not abide by the will of the Father. And therefore he suffers. God just watches. And I say, praise. Do not expect him to magically intervene in your lives. He has already done the best he could. He is already doing the best he can. God is not a miser. He has not kept something back with himself to be released at an opportune time. The absolute is an absolute giver as well. Absolutely he has given. The rest is upon us. It is totally our prerogative what we make of this life.